Okay, so we are, the title of my talk is Organocatalysis, Origins and Relevance. So here, me, Biju and myself are going to give you an overview about organocatalysis, basically. So what I will do, because I'm the one who is given the responsibility to start the proceedings, I will give you a historical outline of this branch of organic synthesis. Not only that, I'll try to place this development. This is a very recent development in organic synthesis. So I'll try to place it in the context of organic chemistry and organic synthesis in particular. In the process, I may touch upon some of the historical aspects, some relevant work from different people, which I personally feel that should be mentioned. And then maybe we can have a few minutes for discussions. So obviously all of you know already that we have joined here on this particular context of the Nobel Prize in chemistry for this year, given to Professor List and to Professor Macmillan. And the Nobel Committee very precisely put the reason for giving this prize to them as for the development of asymmetric organocatalysis. Very sharp, asymmetric organocatalysis. Although it's very sharp in this definition, the history of this not that that well appreciated. So that's what we will try to do in the coming slides. So for that, for the benefit of the younger colleagues in the audience, let me just start with the art of organic synthesis. Some of these things, or most of these things, will be quite trivial to the senior people in the audience. I beg their pardon, because I'm trying to create some historical awareness for the younger people. So please bear with me if some of these things sounds a little bit trivial. So you have all heard organic synthesis, the theme, the science, the art. But what is it? The first person to use the theme synthesis was Hermann Kolbe, a very important organic chemist. You have probably studied Kolbe's acetic acid synthesis and Kolbe process and all those things. He used synthesis. His synthesis was an already existing theme in philosophy. For the roughly, it means that you combine two different ideas, two existing schools of thought in philosophy, or two ideas, and then out of this combination emerges a new thought or a new idea, which is not necessarily like the two ideas that you combine. So something else, when you combine these two ideas, a new property emerges. And that's the idea of synthesis in philosophy. And exactly, this is a very apt term for a chemical synthesis also. You combine two reagents or two reactants, and then you get a new product, which will have a very different properties from either of the starting materials. So Kolbe very aptly gave a name for the branch of science that we practice today. And it is appreciated that it is not just a science, it has also a lot of creative side to it. So people prefer to call it as the art. Some people call it molecular architecture, molecular engineering. So different fancy names are given, but organic synthesis is a heavy enough term to describe what we are trying to do. For the benefit of younger colleagues, there are two types of targets for synthesis. So you can approach synthesis in different ways. So you can approach it in a way of targeting something. You can target natural products, something that already exists in nature for some reason. I will explain to you the reasons in coming slides. Also, you can make molecules that never existed in nature. And that's one of the most important aspects of synthesis. You can create, man can create things that never existed. So you will design, obviously, some structure and make it for some purpose. That's based on the target. But there is another approach in organic synthesis, Now, there are two types of people in organic synthesis. One type of people think about the target all the time and then try to make it. And we call that approach as total synthesis. So they are focused on the target molecule. Another type of work is actually think about developing new reactions. And these two go hand in hand and they overlap also. But these are roughly a broad classification of people who engage in organic synthesis. Do either of these things or both of these things to varying extent. Now, some of you may ask, if something is existing in nature already there, why do you spend all this time, resources, and effort in the lab to make it? There could be several reasons for it. So let me give you two or three reasons for why someone should be mad enough to make a natural product in laboratory spending a hell lot of time. The first obvious reason is that the natural source may be very rare. To give an example, you can see in this slide a picture of a tribal person hunting using a bow, blow arrow. You know, they can shoot an arrow by blowing into that long pipe. And you can see the arrow and one frog, colorful looking frog. These frogs are found in South America, in the Amazon forests of Brazil and southern countries. These frogs secrete some sort of syrup on their skin, an oil, and that oil is poisonous. So these tribal people use these frogs, rub these arrows in that oil, the arrow tips, and then shoot it to catch the prey. So even if the arrow just touches the prey, the poison in that arrow tip is sufficient enough to kill the animal, and not there won't be enough poison to endanger people who will eat that killed animal. Obviously, they will eat it after cooking. So again, the poison is decomposed. But So this information was known to people from outside this tribal area. So some of the natural product chemists collected this oil, extracted the active component of it, and found out many compounds. One of them is shown here, histrionicotoxin. And many studies were done with this compound and found that these compounds can also have anti-cancer activities. This is a member of a large number of a class of that contains a large number of similar compounds. So now we have found a potential use for this compound, and further studies need to be done. You need gram quantities of this compound. So what's our option? You have two options: either capture a large number of the species of frog, harm them, potentially even kill them, or you know the structure of the compound. We can approach it in another way, make it in the lab. So obviously the second option is what any civilized society would take. So there goes the first reason to undertake natural product organic synthesis in the lab. Second reason, sometimes this occasionally happens. Sometimes there would be a very abundant natural product, but strange reasons, historical, political, or geographic reasons may make it scarce for some time. Something like this happened during the Second World War. You all heard about malaria. Malaria is treated by the drug quinine. Quinine is plenty available from the tree of cinchona tree, the bark of cinchona tree. Cinchona tree is native to South America, but once its importance was realized, European forces cultivated it in their colonies where the weather climate conditions were similar. And a large plantations of cinchona tree was mostly in the island of Borneo, the present-day Indonesia. Indonesia forest, rainforests are very similar to the South American rainforests, tropical. So that's where the whole supply of quinine for the whole world was coming. And Europeans required it in large amounts because to sustain the colonies of tropical countries, they had to survive in those countries, and malaria was a big challenge. Now, during the Second World War, Japanese forces captured most of East Asia, Indonesia included. They even came to India, you know, up to our borders in Assam. If you go to Jorhat, you can see where Jorhat in Assam, the Japanese forces came even up to that point. So everything east of India up to Japan was under Japanese control. There was no supply of quinine. War was going on. The Europeans or the whole Western world was frantically searching for quinine. And organic synthesis was quite a bit established by that time, and all the chemists went to lab, started working on a synthesis of quinine, and Robert B. Woodward, R. B. Woodward, the greatest, probably the greatest organic chemist in terms of synthesis ever lived, achieved this feat, or at least he claimed to have achieved this feat. And normally a synthesis work gets published in a journal, but here the news was published in New York Times as a headline. The headline was Harvard Chemist Saves the World. The idea was this: we can make quinine in the lab, we don't need to depend on supplies from Indonesia. So historical situations, this is an extreme case, but there are situations where a timely or abundant supply of natural products may not be available. That then also you have to go to synthetic chemists to ensure such supplies. Last reason, there are more, but I'm just taking some of the most obvious and important reasons. Or this is one of the most significant cases. See, nature makes complicated molecules for a defined purpose. These are evolved over millennia by a natural evolution. And we identify some properties of those molecules that could be useful for us. Look at the example given on the right side of this slide. Camptothecin is a natural product. It has anti-cancer properties, but it also has severe toxicity associated. You cannot use it as a drug because if you take it, okay, some cancer cells may die, but some of your healthy cells will also die. And especially this affects the bladder in the body. So what do? You don't throw it away. Increased and the undesirable side effects are reduced. And this is what medicinal chemists do. And taking camptothecin, medicinal chemists developed two analogs, irinotecan and belotecan. You can see the structures. They're very similar to the natural product, but there are some additions to the structures. I think probably belotecan structure is not correct. I have given the same structure, but just understand that these are very close analogs, but nature will not produce them. You have to make them in the lab. So you have to make a strategy to make natural products and similar molecules. This is only possible by synthesis. So how we are actually alive today? Most of the drugs that we use are developed starting from a natural product origin. The final drug that is marketed may not be looking very similar to it, but point of origin, the idea originates from a natural product mostly. More than 60% of drugs are developed starting from a natural product. Nature cannot produce whatever we want, so we have to make them in the lab. And for this, you need to develop synthesis which is flexible to give you different analogs, only possible in the lab. Okay, that probably is enough to convince you why natural product synthesis is not a crazy thing to do. Now, let me come back to the point where I mentioned about two types of chemists, those who do total synthesis, those who may develop synthetic methodology. This difference between these two classes of people can be explained taking this a little bit of a silly analogy here. You can see on the left side a cycle, bicycle. See, if you are using riding a bicycle, and occasionally it breaks down, or something wrong goes on, and then you have to fix it. And you would need a toolbox. To fix a cycle, the toolbox that you would require is probably something like that shown in this picture, right next to the cycle. So a simple synthetic task that you face in the lab can be solved like this with the common tools that is already available in a normal toolbox. For example, preparation of parabromoacetanilide. This is an experiment that you do in the lab for BAC. Now you can break it down to aniline, acetylation, and then bromination. You don't need two specialized tool kit for this. Now imagine you are riding a very fancy car like the one that you see on the picture on the right. And if it breaks down, our spanner and plier and hammer would not give you a decent solution, would probably damage the vehicle more. So you need a very sophisticated tool set. As your task become more complicated, look at the molecule below the car, that is Taxol. So if your task is to assemble a part of Taxol, then you can't work with hammer and plier. As the problems becomes more sophisticated, so the tools must be also. So this is why people develop synthetic methodologies. When there should be tool makers for any trade to flourish, you need a steady supply of tools for the task that you may face. So who supplies these tools, synthetic tools? The supplier of those synthetic tools is the people who develop methodologies. And those who focus on total synthesis, occasionally they try to develop tools because nobody else is developing it for them, and it's a very specific task. But mostly they work with the tools developed by the synthetic methodology developers. So these go, these are complementary, and people work in both areas also, just to understand how it feels to start from a problem and fully address it. So this is a fact that practicing organic synthesis chemists understand, but not fully appreciated by chemists from or scientists from other areas. So this is one reason why I have put it up here. Now, the contents in this slide is probably not familiar to, or the students may not have faced it, but I have faced it a lot. So that's, and it has irritated me to a large extent, so that's why I'm addressing it here. You often hear that organic synthesis is a very matured area, and it's almost like, okay, it's all done. This statement I heard a lot, I still hear a lot, and it's a very naive statement to make. Some legendary physicist, Lord Kelvin, you know him, Kelvin, the scale of temperature is named after him. He's also known, his real name is Thomson, Joule Thomson effect. The Thomson comes from, the name Thomson comes from Kelvin. Kelvin is his, kind of a name that they give to the English locks. So he made a statement in 1900, there is nothing new to be discovered in physics now. All that remains is more and more precise measurement. It was not a common man making the statement, one of the biggest physicists of his time. And in the same year, he was proven completely wrong, splendidly, by Max Planck. And they were not trying to prove him wrong, but historically he was proven wrong by the advent of quantum mechanics and special relativity 5 years later by Einstein. Classical physics moved aside for the new physics, modern physics that you all study today. Kelvin, you cannot blame Kelvin. It looked like everything is covered now to Kelvin, but you know, never think that in science. This is a lesson, basic lesson in science, that there is no end to the human pursuit of science. You don't know what will happen in the next moment, and then completely new idea or a revolutionary idea may come up. So, but this is happening with organic synthesis also. Such claims are made by people who are not at the stature of Lord Kelvin, but for various reasons. So I have listed two claims that people make about organic synthesis on the table. The first one of them is that we now know that any complex molecule can be made in the lab. There is no need for any more reaction development. You hear this when you go and present proposals for funding. So what is my feeling about this claim? So first of all, it is not true. We don't know that any molecule can be made. Even a simple molecule can pose challenge. There is a structure that I have drawn in red color that is an ethylene with four tertiary butyl groups, tetra tertiary butyl ethylene. This molecule is very simple. It's a simple ethylene derivative. No one has been able to make it. People have tried a lot. People have tried to calculate whether it can exist because the steric hindrance between that tertiary butyl group, whether will make it too unstable to exist. So, you can't say that any complex molecule can be made. Even simple molecules cannot be made. Second reason that this could be arising out of normal, I mean, ignorance about the science. Okay, that can be pardoned, but it can arise also from malice, deliberate untruth. That cannot be pardoned. Another reason why people make such a statement is that they are so used to seeing complex molecules being made daily in hundreds, unbelievable feats of synthesis coming out from different laboratories. And they think it's okay, it's a matter of daily routine. Actually, it is not. Those who do it will understand that it is a real big challenge. And maybe you can take this statement as a compliment to the capabilities of organic chemists all over the world. Okay, that's one question, claim that you hear. The second claim is now you must focus on synthesizing not just any random structure, but you should focus on synthesizing properties, some make something useful. That's a reasonable claim. But then, none of us know anything clear about structure activity relationship in any field. What we have at the moment is educated guesses and patterns. So if I ask someone to make a compound that would absorb in this particular wavelength and it would have a property of liquid crystallinity between temperatures minus 10 to plus 40 and also have a high thermal stability and also should be colored yellow, I give so many conditions and ask somebody to draw up a structure that would satisfy all these conditions. Any scientist worth his penny would say, no, it's impossible to predict. All you can say is, okay, let's start with this particular structure based on some already known analogs and then work around it. Which means, if you want to synthesize property, you have to make educated guesses, make compounds, test it, optimize, I mean, change structure here and there. Sometimes you have to abandon the whole idea and start again. So we are not at a stage where we can predict properties of molecules by looking at the structure and do research. So then how do people do it? People do it by taking guesses, as I said, and then they go for synthesis. And when they go for synthesis, the people who focus on properties, what they do is they rely on very existing, established, reliable, confident synthetic routes. And these routes are established after the, I don't know, why are they confident about taking a particular route? Because it has been shown by generations of chemists to be very useful. And that approach limits them to a known or a well-existing class of compounds only. They are not going to arrive at a fantastic molecule with an excellent property by limiting themselves to known classes of compounds. New structures and new methods can only drive the progress in other areas. So those who try to say synthesis is sufficient now, we can just focus on applications, are actually limiting their own progress by limiting progress in synthesis. This is probably something that people don't understand. Okay, so I will stop my rant on the importance of organic synthesis at this point because I have taken a lot of time, I think. Yes. Now let me go to the importance of asymmetric synthesis. I think Biju will explain a little bit more on this later. But making molecules is not sufficient. Making exact stereoisomers is required. And this importance of asymmetric synthesis is unfortunately made famous or infamous by the incident of thalidomide disaster. Thalidomide was a drug. You can see the structure prescribed to pregnant ladies for morning sickness in the 1950s and 60s. At that time, nobody bothered. Thalidomide was marketed as a racemic version. And a lot of the kids born in that generation were born with defects, birth defects, limbs. Hands and legs were not developed. And this prompted a study, and then it was traced down to thalidomide. The S isomer of thalidomide caused this problem. The R thalidomide is safe. It actually is the useful drug, but the S thalidomide is a very dangerous thing. So there you go. Because our system, body, recognizes the differences between these two molecules, and two different biological results are produced. So this unfortunate tragedy reminded medicinal chemists, pharmacy, pharma world, and organic chemists that we must make chiral molecules selectively as separate enantiomers, and then only test them for any application that you are planning to do. And then we have this explosion of activity in asymmetric synthesis, which has been recognized very well. Recently, maybe not very recently, 20 years ago, exactly 20 years ago, some of the major contributions in this area was recognized by giving Nobel Prize to three people, Knowles, Noyori, and Sharpless, for their contributions in asymmetric synthesis. The committee said Knowles and Noyori gets it for chirally catalyzed hydrogenation reactions. Sharpless got it for chirally catalyzed oxidation reactions. So chiral oxidations, chiral reductions. But these generation of chemists, these three and a lot of the chemists before them, used asymmetric catalysis using metals. Rhodium and ruthenium were the main metals for hydrogenation catalyst. Titanium, obviously, you must have studied Sharpless asymmetric epoxidation using titanium and other chiral ligands. You know, chirality was always given by the ligands, but the center of the activity was metal. So their tools were metallic, and it was good, but there were some challenges faced by people who use metals. Metals were toxic, rare, expensive. It was difficult to remove traces of metals from final products, and that was a serious challenge for applications in medicinal chemistry. Let me skip this. I think that's not an important slide. Okay, so this problem was addressed when organocatalysis started to emerge. Organocatalysis is catalysis of organic reactions by small organic molecules. Why do we say small organic molecules? Because we just start to differentiate between biocatalysis and organocatalysis. Biocatalysis is also catalysis by organic molecules, but these are real big molecules like enzymes, or you may use whole cells or even bacteria or microorganisms themselves in a bioreactor. But the job is done by enzymes. So enzymes are not small. So we say, okay, biocatalysis, let's keep it aside. It has already been there. So organocatalysis is very, very small molecules that catalyze organic reactions, no metals. And many discussions on organocatalysis start with a name reaction called Hajos Parrish, and there's a long list of names. Let's call it Hajos Parrish reaction for saving the time. This was a patent that came out in 1970s, but that's not correct. That's not the starting point of organocatalysis, but that's a very important start a point. That's a moment of, discovery or the discovery that gave a lot of boost. But organocatalysis was there much before that, but people did not know that it was organocatalysis. Now, in hindsight, when we look back with the knowledge of what is organocatalysis, then we realize that there were reactions in literature that actually belong to organocatalysis. You can even see it from 1860 by Liebig, the hydration of cyanogen. Okay, you look at the scheme, cyanogen is in the middle. On the right side of the scheme, you can see hydration of cyanogen to give oxamide. Oh, so all you need is water, but when you just add water, you don't get the oxamide. You get a horrible mixture of products, not oxamide. But if you add a catalytic amount of acetaldehyde, quantitative yield of oxamide is formed. Liebig published this, and Liebig said that acetaldehyde is acting like ferments. Ferments were the name given for enzymes that time. So you see, Liebig was had a very sharp, long sight. He exactly hit the point. Acetaldehyde acted like an enzyme because it's an organic molecule, and it catalyzed this reaction just like enzymes do, very effectively. And that's actually the idea behind organocatalysis, something like enzymes. Another reaction, very old reaction, that very clearly, evidently, is an organocatalytic reaction is Knobnagel condensation. You know, Knobnagel reported in 1894 and 96, two reactions catalyzed by secondary amines. In the first case, he used diethylamine for the condensation between diethylmalonate and formaldehyde, which gives a condensation plus Michael addition product. In 1896, he made a general discovery that we can condense diethylmalonate with various aldehydes when if you use piperidine at a, and heat it. You get the Knobnagel effect, basically. Now, this is actually a proper organocatalyzed reaction. You are using piperidine, a secondary amine, to activate the aldehyde. Now, secondary amine condenses with aldehyde to form an iminium ion. And iminium ion is a much stronger electrophile than the aldehyde. It's positively charged. And it can react with the active methylene compound much more effectively. So secondary amines and the iminium ion, this is a very, very, this story goes a long way, even now. Half of the organocatalyzed reactions belong to this category. So that story actually starts from Knobnagel, iminium ion catalysis. And there is one isolated example that people have found out later. In 1912, two people called Breding and Feske reported that quinine and quinidine can catalyze cyanohydrin formations. Not much is known about, nothing was investigated after this, but again, quinine and pinidine are well-known organocatalysts nowadays. So the idea was not new. You know, people were already familiar with their catalytic activity at 1912. Okay, these are just for historical information. I'm not saying that these are revolutionary discoveries, but when you realize something that's important and look back, we cannot ignore the people who realized or tried the same ideas at a far earlier time. And they may not have known the relevance at that time, but it is important to appreciate at our time that these kind of contributions were made. Now, something legendary in the area of not just organocatalysis, but the whole organic synthesis came out in the 50s, the enamine alkylation. It was the solution to one of the most puzzling, challenging problems of that time, alkylation of carbonyl compounds. Enolate alkylations were very difficult at that time. They did not have lithium bases. Lithium bases were also introduced by Stork Achermatt in later period. So Stork, Professor Gilbert Stork, in the 1950s, introduced the idea that enamines can be used as specific enolate equivalents for acylation, alkylation, aldol reactions, Michael additions. So basically, you can use carbonyl compounds as regioselective enolate equivalent by converting them into enamines. And it's textbook chemistry that you are learning nowadays. But in addition to the importance of that reaction in organic synthesis in general, this also forms the basis of enamine catalysis that is, you know, as important as iminium ion catalysis in organocatalysis. The foundational aspects of enamine catalysis lies here. Obviously, Stork did not use amine as a catalyst for enamine formation, but the idea was hidden in this particular discovery. Why was enamines important? Here you have Professor Stork's picture and the whole sequence of reactions. Secondary amines condense with carbonyl compounds. You may look at the scheme and follow what I'm trying to tell you. Secondary amines condense to form iminium ions. And iminium ions will stay as iminium ions if there are no alpha hydrogens. But you know, it will be an equilibrium simply. If you have an alpha hydrogen, the compound can become neutral by eliminating a proton, losing a proton. Overall, ejection of a water molecule, and you can get enamine, which is a neutral stable molecule if you don't put acid or water into it. But then isolate the enamines, do the reaction. Alkylation goes through the same iminium ion intermediate, which gets hydrolyzed back to original carbonyl group. So the unique feature of secondary amines are utilized here. You will see a lot of secondary amines in organocatalysis because it's secondary amines that can form iminium ions, because it's secondary amines that can form enamines. So secondary amines are the superstars compared to primary or tertiary amines when it comes to organocatalysis. Another big name that opened up an equally important branch of organocatalysis, the N-heterocyclic carbene catalysis. Another legendary chemist from the same department of University of Columbia, Ronald Breslow. Professor Stork was from University of Columbia. Breslow was also University of Columbia. Unfortunately, both of them left us 2017, I guess, 4 years ago, around the same time. Okay, what did Breslow do? It was known that certain coenzymes containing enzymes containing the coenzyme part of thiazolium could catalyze biochemical reactions like pyruvic acid decarboxylation and benzoin or acetoin condensation. And Breslow, with the insight of a trained organic chemist, explained how it is happening. His explanation is given in that scheme. You can look at the thiazolium salt on the top left, which has a hydrogen at that aromatic ring, which is quite acidic, which can be removed by bases to form a thiazolium elide. That elide also retains aromaticity, so that's not very unstable. You can form that. Breslow drawn that elide structure only, but you can also draw a carbene structure there, a neutral structure, elide and a neutral structure, elide and a carbene structure. So that elide actually explains the reactivity. That carbanion can react with aldehydes, for example, in benzoin condensation. And a proton shift forms a neutral intermediate, which we now call as Breslow intermediate. You can see that on the second line of the scheme. That's a neutral intermediate. So it's stable. It has some existence. People have isolated it, observed it, trapped it. So it's a very real thing. It's not a proposed intermediate or anything, it's a real intermediate in which you can see an enamine. It's actually an enamine as well as a thiaenamine, and there is an OH group, so it's also an enol. But the polarization of that double bond is dominated by the electron donation from nitrogen and sulfur. So our original aldehyde carbon is now nucleophilic, which we call as umbilum, and it can react with other electrophiles, for example, another molecule of benzaldehyde, and a couple of proton shifts, ejection of the catalyst, again, it gives you benzoin. Brilliant explanation of what's happening. He explained pyruvic acid decarboxylation by a similar mechanism. Also, Stetter reaction can be explained in a similar mechanism. Now, this result was lying there for a long time, and then people picked it up to develop N-heterocyclic carbene catalysis at later stage. Just like the enamine alkylation was lying there, which allowed people to pick up enamine catalysis. So these two are two legendary organic chemists who actually paved way for modern organocatalysis, but not appreciated sometimes in that way, because we tend to focus on the asymmetric organocatalysis of more recent times. It's important to look at the roots and appreciate the people who has contributed to build a strong foundation on which the fancy looking top floors are built. Okay, that's more visible, but definitely don't forget the foundations. That's why I have included their contributions here. Now, there are a couple of reactions that you have studied probably. They are also organocatalytic reactions. Now people have started to discuss Bailey-Silman reaction as an organocatalytic reaction recently, but it's an old reaction, which clearly was a organocatalytic reaction. Dabco is the catalyst here. Staglish esterification, which is esterification method that you use when you have to make tertiary butyl esters, for example. Tertiary butanol will not react under normal Fischer esterification conditions there, because it's so bulky. It does not like to behave as a nucleophile, go and attack a carbonyl group of the carboxylic acid. So what do? You have to activate the acid to a much reactive intermediate, and that's done by using DCC or carbodiimides and DMAP. DMAP is essential here in catalytic amount. Without that, the reaction doesn't work. And DMAP is a nucleophile that activates the acid, the intermediate in this reaction. So these are two reactions, sort of classical reactions, which are actually organocatalytic reactions. I'm not saying this to discuss the reactions in detail, just to tell you that the story of organocatalysis is not complete without these instances. Now let me come to a little bit of Indian contributions in this area. We are celebrating the Nobel Prize for organocatalysis. So let's also celebrate a significant contributions that has been made from India. This one is quite remarkable, which I was not aware of. Thanks to Biju for pointing out this to me recently, that Professor Swaminathan from the University of Madras. University of Madras has produced some legendary results and legendary people, and he is one of them. In 1990, not so long ago, but not so recently, he reported an asymmetric reaction catalyzed by proline. Okay, so what he did was, it's kind of Robinson annihilation. Starting from, the scheme is a little complicated, let me explain to you. You start from the starting compound on the left, 4-methyl cyclohexanone. Okay, and now look at the top scheme. You treat that first with methyl vinyl ketone and a base, a Michael addition happens. And you take that product, crude product. Take the crude product and dissolve it in DMSO, add proline, catalytic amount, let it stir for a few days. He isolated 70% of an intramolecular aldol product. So it's like a Robinson annihilation overall, but he isolated the S product in excellent purity, the S isomer, enantiomerically pure. Now he thought, okay, let's make it effective, make it a one-port operation. So he just simply added the proline catalyst first. Now look at the bottom part of the scheme. Proline catalyst first in DMSO, stirred it for 12 hours, to the same reaction mixture added methyl vinyl ketone. So change the order of events. Same product was isolated, but analysis showed that it is the other enantiomer, R enantiomer. Similar sort of yield, 70 and 80%. But enantiomeric purity completely, enantiomeric identity completely reversed. This is a very remarkable result. And what is the chiral agent here? It's proline in catalytic amount. Proper organocatalytic reaction, and it has to go in discussions as the next big thing after the Hajos-Parrish reaction, but somehow it is underappreciated. Even I did not know this about this until Biju pointed out this to me, because it was published in Indian Journal of Chemistry. It's seldom discussed in the international circles. Very remarkable result, I think at least our chemist should be aware of. Unfortunately, not a lot was built on this afterwards. In 10 years' time, List was to come out with proline catalyzed aldol reactions intermolecular. Okay, some contributions from my own guru on organocatalysis. There has actually a huge body of work from Dr. Nair's group in this. People in this audience have done this themselves with their own hands, I know. People like me, Biju, and Aniditi have done these kind of reactions. So again, let me explain from starting from the middle of the scheme. You can see a acetylenic diester in the middle in a box, which is a common feature of these reactions. Let's start from the middle to the left. You react that with a benzaldehyde using pyridine, catalytic amount. Now We have dimethylacetylene dicarboxylate and benzaldehyde. Both are excellent electrophiles. They won't react normally. But in the presence of a catalytic amount of pyridine, a very common cheap substance that's lying in any lab, you can combine these two electrophiles together to form a new product. You can see a new CC bond between the two components shown in red on the left side. Similarly, you can do the same sort of reaction with N-tosylamines on the right side, electron deficient alkenes. Okay, all are electrophiles basically. You can combine dimethylacetylene dicarboxylate with a variety of electrophiles just by adding a bit of pyridine. So this is just a selection of the work. I'm just for the people who are curious about how does this happen, how do two electrophiles come together in presence of pyridine. Here is the rationalization. Pyridine obviously is nucleophilic, reacts with the stronger of the electrophile, dimethylacetylene dicarboxylate, forms a dipole. Now you get a dipole. Now dipole is generated in catalytic amount, but it will meet another molecule of benzaldehyde lying around, forms a CC bond. Okay, this is where the CC bond is formed. Now, temporarily, we have converted one of the electrophiles into nucleophiles by pushing some electrons into it from pyridine. That's it. Very simple idea. Now, once that CC bond is formed, now the charge is negative charge is on oxygen. Things are a little bit better. So it does not go back that easily. And then one hydrogen shift from that benzylic hydrogen, which is quite acidic in view of the conjugation with the double bond, can move to the carbon. So basically it's a 1,3 hydrogen shift. And once that 1,3 hydrogen shift happens, you can have a conformation of this whole extended dipole that is suitable for a 1,4 elimination. Just like you study E2 elimination, this is a 1,4 elimination where the leaving group and that electrons have to be antiperiplana. All those four atoms should be in one plane. Pyridine is eliminated. You get a stable product. Pyridine, eliminated pyridine can do its job again. So this is how it works. This is a very simple idea, but you will find this idea at the root of many remarkable reactions in organocatalysis, including asymmetric organocatalysis. So very complex, nice looking, fancy looking things are built on simple ideas generally, if you dig down deep enough. Some of those kind of reactions are summarized in a Accounts of Chemical Research article by Dr. Nair, if anybody is interested. Some very interesting and important contributions in NHC catalyzed stereoselective reactions also came out from Dr. Nair's group. Two examples are shown here. There are plenty, but I'm just showing two relevant examples that I thought would be ideal for this audience. The first one that came in 2006 is a combination of cinnamaldehyde and chalcones in the presence of N-heterocyclic carbenes to form cyclopentenes. Very, very stereoselective and very unusual reaction. The mechanism is quite interesting, but that's not the point of our discussion today. So I'll leave it to people who are interested. They can read the paper. Another reaction, cinnamaldehyde again, adding to a Michael acceptor, nitrostyrenes, in a stereoselective manner. So here in both these reactions, what happens is cinnamaldehyde becomes a nucleophile at the beta position, the benzylic position becomes, nucleophilic. We call it a homoenolate. And that reacts with other electrophiles in various manners. A lot of other Indian chemists have also done excellent work in asymmetric catalysis. So this is a combination of the contributions of Indian chemists. So status of asymmetric catalysis in India during the last 10 years, a review published by Professor Dhamachari of University of Hyderabad in Proceedings of Indian National Academy in 2020, last year. And he has listed the names of prominent people in that cover picture. You can see, if you look on the left side, you can see an arrow, and on the left side of that arrow, you can see the next speaker of our seminar, Biju. His contributions are also very prominent and described in this review. Those who are interested in Biju's work may go and see the Accounts of Chemical Research article just below, shown at the bottom of the slide, focusing on alpha beta unsaturated acyl azolum. It's NHC catalysis, asymmetric catalysis. A lot of people are working in India also, and all of these, you know, none of them won the Nobel Prize, but all of this is collective contributions which enriches the field and makes it more important. And everybody can actually claim a share of the glory. And there is no shame in that, because science is not built by one person. It is built by contributions from everywhere. And, you know, you pick up brilliant ideas, brilliant hints for important discoveries from very, very simple or unrelated sources of inspiration. So I think all of these people can be quite proud of the Nobel Prize for this year for asymmetric organocatalysis. Okay, now let me try to wind up by just showing some unique features of organocatalysis. I already mentioned it. Secondary amines have a unique place, because they have this ability to make carbonyl compounds into an electrophile by forming an aminium ion, or a nucleophile forming an enamine. And often they do both to two different substrates in the same reaction. And it's like dual activation. Now, when you look at proline, which is a very, very popular catalyst, you already seen an example. Proline is so special among amino acids because it's only secondary amino acids. And it's obviously, it also has a protic acid group. So the Hajos-Parrish reaction of 1974 uses proline for as a catalyst for an enantioselective intramolecular aldol reaction. Now proline works because it's a secondary amine. Proline is also, you know, it has that, if you look at the box on the bottom right, it has a little bit of similarity with the peptide chain. Other amino acids don't, because it has NH2. Here the NH is tied back into a ring, and that part of proline looks like that it just been cut off from a peptide chain. So it's viewed as a prototype of a type of an enzyme by many chemists because of that secondary amine part of proline. Now let me just tell you the a bit about basics about the Hajos-Parrish reaction. Hajos-Parrish reaction is a German patent in 1974 that described proline as a catalyst for asymmetric formation of the Hajos-Parrish ketol or Hajos-Parrish ketone. It's an aldol reaction. First product is the aldol product. Second is the, if you just heat it with a little bit of acid, you get elimination of water, you get the aldol condensation. Hauck has done a lot of calculations and explained, also considering the experiments, kinetic experiments done by others, that an enamine formed from proline and the ketone, that methyl ketone of our starting material, as shown in this picture on the right side, is the key intermediate. And that's pretty accepted. But for the benefit of our students, let me give you a little bit more explanation to that. You look at the scheme on the bottom, the first one on top, it's basically the same enamine that Hauck has proposed, but it's not from proline. We simply have a secondary amine, no chirality. Okay, now this enamine has two options. It can react with the carbonyl group on the five-membered ring. There are two carbonyl groups, the front one and the back one. It's equally possible. Both are equidistant. There is nothing to differentiate between the reaction between them. But the results would be different. You will get enantiomers. If the front one reacts, you will get a product. If the back one reacts, you will get the enantiomeric product. So such processes are called desymmetrization. So that aldol reaction is actually a desymmetrizing aldol reaction. Now, when the secondary amine is proline. Now look at the picture on the top bottom right in the box. Now our secondary amine is proline. Proline has a fixed absolute stereochemistry. Now that carboxylic group will do everything that is required for breaking the symmetry. That carboxylic acid is already fixed in an absolute configuration, and it will bind with one of the carbonyl groups from this particular intermediate, and that would be activated by protonation or hydrogen bonding. And then obviously that's more reactive, and a selective attack on that carbonyl will be happening. So this is a view of the view from a desymmetrization angle of this second allo reaction. You may see other types of discussions, but I thought it would be interesting to look at it from this angle also. I think if you draw it with your own hands, you will appreciate it more. For those who are interested, please try that. And this is what happens in the Hajos-Parrish reaction. And everything was lying there. Hajos-Parrish reaction was there for a long time and nothing happened till 2000. Then came two people, List from one side from Germany and Macmillan from the US. List, Lerner and Barbas reported proline catalyzed asymmetric aldol reactions with acetone and aldehydes. Proline 30 mole percent in DMSO, you get excellent EE. The enamine pathway is described in the scheme. We can see in colored picture how enamine is formed from acetone, and the acid part of proline holds the carbonyl component in the correct, exposes the correct phase when the R group is pointed to its pseudo-equatorial position. And this is the pioneering publication from the List group for opening modern asymmetric organocatalysis. Details of this you will hear from Biju. At the same time, from the US, Macmillan came out with another secondary amine catalyst, but this time for a different, equally important reaction, Diels-Alder reaction. So you have on one side aldol, on the other side, Diels-Alder. Two of the core reactions in organic chemistry. Macmillan used a catalyst which is now known as Macmillan catalyst, made from amino acids. And this one uses iminium pathway. What happens is shown in the scheme below. You know, the dienophile aldehyde is, interacts with the secondary amine catalyst, forms an iminium ion. Iminium ion is more reactive now towards Diels-Alder. It's just like Lewis acid activation. This is, it's protonated. The iminium ion is positively polarized, very reactive. So the Diels-Alder reaction goes at room temperature very effectively. It's also chiral. The iminium ion has a chiral side chain which blocks one phase of the dienophile. So you get a very selective, enantioselective Diels-Alder reaction, single isomer, excellent EE. So this is the simultaneous discovery of a different organocatalytic Diels-Alder reaction, which again is counted as the starting point of modern asymmetric organocatalysis. So these two people opened the gates and a lot others joined. And the rest is history, as they say.